It is 3:33, so I am going to hereby call this meeting of the Other Post-Employment Benefits Trustees Committee to order. And Erin, can you take roll? Do you mind? Sorry, I didn't prepare you to do that.
Mary Lamont.
Here.
Fran McGregor.
Present.
Mark Mathers.
Present.
Mindy Capron. And Jessica Young. And Jeffrey Kirst.
Present.
Okay, very good. At this time, we invite public comment. Seeing no one in the audience as usual, we have no public comment. So we move on to agenda item 2.01, approval of the minutes for our committee meeting on May 26, 2022. Thank you, Erin, for taking some beefed up minutes. Does anyone have any changes to those draft minutes to make?
No changes from Jeff Kirst.
Okay. Mary, did we spell your name right?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay, then I will take a motion to approve the minutes of May 26th.
Fran McGregor, I move we approve the minutes from May 26th.
Great.
Mary Lamont, I second that.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Nay?
Aye.
Okay. Hearing no nays, motion was approved unanimously. So now we move on to agenda item 2.02, which is a discussion of the OPEB Trust Fund fiscal year 22 fourth quarter financial statements.
Okay, bye.
And to present that is Jessica Young, our district controller.
That is primarily attributed to the differences in the investments in fiscal year 21 did very well, but we have an unrealized loss as of the year end of June 30th, 2022. That is primarily why we saw that decrease in fund balance. Otherwise, everything was pretty in line year over year. So if anybody has any questions, I can address those.
Any questions? We're looking at the statement of revenues, expenditures, and changes in net position, the first page on this item. Okay, no questions?
No questions on that from Jeff Kirst.
Okay.
The balance sheet is showing the decrease in net position of 6.6 million and the RBIF investment account is where we're seeing the unrealized losses that are creating the decrease in net position. So RBIF is where we hold the any excess amounts to be invested by the state, and we can see that the investments did very well in fiscal year 21. We didn't really lose this money in fiscal year 22. It's just an unrealized loss. So it's the value of the investments went down, but we haven't sold them yet. So we haven't really taken a loss on that.
Any questions? Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, and that item was for discussion only. The next item is a review of the Retirement Benefits Investment Fund portfolio's returns for the period ended June 30th of 2022. This is for discussion only as well. We gathered this from the Nevada PERS, of course, and so just to kind of support what Jessica was going over, on page 2 of that report, you can see how investments performed for fiscal year 22, and as Jessica noted, we had very strong returns in 21, you'll remember, pretty unprecedented, actually. And so, as is the case with the stock market, things can go up, things can go down. So on page 2, hopefully you can see that for fiscal year 22, the fiscal year ended June 30th, we did see a negative total return of 10.6 in U.S. stocks, a total return of minus 16.5% for non-U.S. stocks, and then even U.S. bonds had a small negative total return of 2.5. So, and that's a reflection of just bond yields increasing over the year. So in total, the blended net return for the RBIF fund was minus 9.4%, which was actually better than the benchmark return of minus 9.8. But still, you know, a sizable negative net return. But you can see the returns for the last 3, 5, and 10 years, which were all very positive and strong. So again, this is what we would expect, fluctuations in the stock market, this happens. So I'll entertain any questions anyone has. The next page, this is kind of a new chart the Nevada PERS staff prepared. It compares total returns of the RBIF's peer group, i.e. other pension systems, other OPEB trusts, and you can see, you know, we are in the top half of returns, certainly, of every period, sometimes at the very top. This last year, not so much, somewhere between the 25th percentile and the median, but still, you know, you can see our relative performance compared to our peers, hopefully, in that chart. It's a little hard to read, I get, but we're the black dot, and then the gray boxes are the range of returns for like agencies. So, you know, that's good to know. And then the next page is kind of a risk return chart, and risk is defined as volatility by public retirement systems, and this shows we have relatively low volatility and yet relatively high returns, which is what you want to see. So that's good. Any questions on those reports? Okay, that was just for discussion only, so.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Mary Lamont, it says legs, total leg on page 4.
Yes.
What does legs mean?
There are 4 different plans that Nevada PERS staff manages, and the PERS total fund, and I guess I actually was reading that, but there's the PERS fund, which, you know, our retirement monies are put away in. Then there is the RBIF fund. So I misread this. You can see the return for RBIF fund. There's actually a little bit greater volatility or standard deviation. That's what that fund was created for, things like OPEB trusts of local governments. And then, so the retirement plan is for general state employees and local government employees. There's a judicial plan for judges. So it's a retirement plan for judges. And then there's a legislative retirement plan for legislators. So yeah. Good question. Okay, hearing no other questions, we will move on briskly to item 2.04, and this is for possible action. And Jessica has the great opportunity to go over this exciting actuarial evaluation. Take it away, Jessica.
Well, GASB 75 is the Governmental Accounting Standards Board issues statements that that governments need to follow in how they present their financial statements. And so in their wisdom, they came out with GASB 75, which tells governments how to present their other post-employment benefits on their financial statements. And what that requires is that we get an actuarial valuation every year to tell us what is our liability for other post-employment benefits. Other post-employment benefits are things that we would pay to employees other than a pension. So it includes any health insurance, dental, vision, life insurance, things of that nature. And what this statement requires is for us to get an estimate of what is that liability for the school district. And so it really is determined by a lot of factors. That's why we have an outside consultant do it, because it has to do with, we give them census data that gives them, you know, who's enrolled in the plan and what are their ages and how many dependents do they have. And so it's based on the census, and it's also based on estimated returns that we would have for our investments. And then what happens is they take the total liability, and then they reduce it by how much we have in our investment account, and we come up with a net OPEB liability. And these figures need to be stated on our financial statements. So now that you know what this is, the net OPEB liability went down substantially in from the last year. We started off at the beginning of the year with a net OPEB liability of $101 million. And by the end of the year, we were down to $84 million. And that has to do with changes that they see in, you know, our populations, as well as changes in assumptions of, like, what investment returns will be. And it can fluctuate, especially when there's a lot of uncertainty on, you know, like interest rates, or, you know, what the rate of return is going to be on our investments. And it actually went down by $17 million from the beginning of the year. So you can see it's a pretty dramatic change on a $100 million liability. Oh, sorry. Okay, so I've been dealing with this report a lot, so so I know exactly where I'm going. But so I'm looking at Exhibit 2, which is how many pages in here? Sorry about that. So yeah, Exhibit 2 is where I get most of the good information that needs to be reported on our financial statements. And so at the top of that table, you'll see in the far right corner is our net OPEB liability at the beginning of the year, which is $101 million. And then when you drop down, the bottom line there of $84 million, that is what we need to report this year on our financial statements.
I have a question, Mary Lamont. So the $101 million is how much it costs to keep OPEB going?
It's what
basically
the, what's the estimated liability at June 30th, 2021?
To pay insurance and that sort of thing.
Future benefits.
Okay.
Yes.
But now you're saying it's only 84 million?
Yes.
Because of people died or gone out or?
A lot of factors can influence it, but primarily it's going to be what your rate of return is long-term for your investments.
Okay. Thank you.
So this is a number, so yeah, it represents the net total number of future benefits for eligible retirees. So we have some retirees like yourself who are drawing benefits now. We have employees who will get benefits in the future. It takes account both groups and calculates based on, yeah, mortality assumptions and other things, what that stream of benefits will be for each and every employee, tallies it up, present value discounts it back down based on the discount rate to come up with kind of the present value of all future benefits for all those who qualify. And we do have a closed system, at least for health insurance, right? So no new employees are eligible to receive benefits. So it's not an easy calculation, but it's a closed system. So we know who's eligible to receive it. And that number, Jessica prepared and Mindy prepare our financial statements, that number then will be reported in the district's financial statements as a, you know, long-term liability that we need to account for and report on and ultimately have to pay and cover. And so you can see the investments that we have are a little less than half of the total liability, which is pretty good.
It's very good.
So we've got that covered. And so the, you know, the hope is that we build up that pot of money and assets that offset those costs, you know. But if that doesn't happen and we have some gap, you know, like we do now, that's what the district's on the hook for, the net OPEB liability. So this is very, very important, and it is nice to see a reduction in our net liability for sure, because we were going the other way a couple years ago. So, yeah, it's good news.
Thank you. Jeff Kirst, a question as we go through this Gallagher report. I don't know that we're down to it yet, but on the OPEB expenses, there was an item for interest cost of $6,494,000 and for service cost of $1,675,000. I wondered what those were for. It's on the Gallagher report.
Yes, I see that. It's in Exhibit 2. Yeah, the service cost and the interest cost. These are calculations that the actuary does to come up with a liability, and I would have to reach out to them and ask them how they come up with those exact numbers.
Okay, if you would, that would be great. Just as Chairman Mathers clarified our allocation question from our last meeting. So I would really like to know about the interest cost and the service cost, what those are.
Okay. And there is a little more detail on them down in Exhibit 4 also. But I will definitely follow up on that with the actuary.
Thank you very much.
Great. Any other questions?
Jeff Kirst, I had one more question on the Gallagher report.
Okay.
If our fine presenter there could give a little bit of an explanation on Exhibit 5, of the deferred inflows and outflows that are on that report? Just a quick explanation.
Well, the deferred inflows and outflows are parts of this calculation that are long-term assets. The deferred outflows are assets, and the deferred inflows represent a liability for this. And I believe it's what the estimated costs over like the next few years that we'll be paying. It's kind of, if you see on Exhibit 5, it shows over the years, like what the estimated deferred inflows and outflows are for this fund.
Yes.
So I can certainly get a little more information on how these things are calculated, if you would like.
That would be great if you would, because it's always been a little confusing for me on deferred items, taxes, and the like. That would be excellent if you could do that.
Okay. And I mean, what I've come up with in these deferred inflows and outflows are not intuitive, like certain things, but they're very comparable to like long-term, like a prepaid expense for the deferred outflows and deferred expenses for the inflows, which is completely counterintuitive to me. I mean, when I'm saying it, I'm thinking that doesn't make any sense. But so it's something that we're measuring that will be future inflows and outflows on the balance sheet.
Understood. Thank you.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay, this is an action item, and we're looking for a motion to accept this report.
Fran McGregor, I move that we accept the Gallagher report as written.
Mary Lamont, I second that.
Okay. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor say aye. Aye.
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, the motion passes unanimously. Thank you, Jessica.
You're welcome.
Our last item is a very simple one. It is an action item. It is our annual affirmation based on the OPEB Trust Agreement that investment income earned by the Washoe County School District OPEB Trust Fund for the fiscal year ended June 30th, 2023, i.e. the fiscal year we're in, will be used for the payment of future benefits of the trust. Kind of what else would they be used for? But we're looking for that annual affirmation, so I would ask for a motion, or if anyone has questions about that, we can try to answer them. Okay, I'll entertain a motion then.
Okay, Fran McGregor, I move that we I move forward with the annual affirmation, item number 2.05.
Okay, all right.
I second that motion.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Hearing none, motion passes unanimously. Thank you. So we're on to closing items. Our next meeting is scheduled, for November 28th, Thanksgiving week. I don't know if you've looked at your calendars. If that doesn't work for you, we can certainly reschedule, but that's what has been scheduled. It's not, okay. Sound good so far? Okay, please let us know if there's something comes up and you can't make it. And like I say, if we have to reschedule, we will. So we're on to item 3.02, public comment. Seeing no members of the public, we will, and hearing no comments, we will adjourn our meeting. Thank you very much for an efficient meeting.